All right, let's start. So we got our, a small group tonight again. So let's finish up on paper 8. Next week, what I want to do next week is actually do Zoom sessions on 6 and 7. So get as far on 6 and 7 as you can so you can ask specific questions. I'll send something out tomorrow in a weekly email on how we're going to do that. It'd be the general way we've been doing it, although I might have larger groups just so we have more time. 6 and 7 are great papers because it's stuff you've had before, like a million times, but you've had it in so many different contexts that it's a chance for you to bring it all together. So I really like 6 and 7. They're more academic papers than anything else. But yeah, if you don't remember that stuff from 3013 or 3030 or corporate finance, I mean, we're doing the same stuff over and over again, but now we're bringing it all together. All right. So what I want to do is, talk some of the stuff we didn't quite finish up last week. So we did this file last week. A couple of things that I did with this file. The first thing I showed you is you go up to the column, and I don't know where I'll put it in y'all's, but it'd be somewhere at the top. In this one, it's in column W. I have the constraints. And so I plugged in some constraints on this model. You have to think about it. You know, this is consumer staples. So, you know, you definitely want margins to dominate. If you're doing tech, you definitely want sales and turnover to dominate. If you're doing heavy machinery, Intel, you probably want return on capital to dominate. So it kind of depends. I wouldn't put constraints in first. I would start it at 0 and run the model and then see what you have and then start thinking about what you would want in your model. Anything you do is going to make the R squared come down. So my R squared came down to 79, but actually it was like lower than that. Remember last class, I deleted one company because it was an outlier. And so I found another outlier and they were way over here. So I got rid of that and that got my R squared back up. So, you know, if you have 50 or more companies, you're doing pretty well. Now, with airlines, with Shamir, it's going to be a little bit tough. I'm probably going to have to bring in some international airlines. The other thing I'm worried about is some of your industries are just devastated. And so when I bring in PE ratios, I'm probably going to get all NAs because they're not making any earnings. So, well, I'll see. I don't know how I'm going to be up at the library all the afternoon, Saturday through late in the night, building all this for y'all. So we'll see how it's going to work. It's going to be interesting. That the consumer staples continuous discretionary should work well, except for I might have to kick out a lot of companies. And again, one of my biggest issues is I can't kick out your company because I have to have it in the model. So it's going to be interesting to see. So there's a model with the constraints, brought the constraints in. So last class, I don't see on here yet, but or maybe it was Alan that asked, I can't remember. But could we add another ratio? And so if you do another ratio, I wouldn't make it part of the ranking model, but you can do ratios like that. Remember that first part of the paper where you're just looking at historical PE ratios and that kind of thing, you know, just where your company lands. So if you want to do like a quasi peg ratio. Well, let's try this as our peg ratio. Let's take EV to sales and divide it by sales growth. Now, why wouldn't we make that our valuation tool over here? Well, you gotta be really careful that you don't use EV to sales as a divided by growth in sales in your evaluation model when you have growth in sales in your factors. I've seen students get real excited because they get an R squared like 98%. And then we discover that we're using sales growth to forecast sales growth. I mean, it's you got a factor in your ranking model on the valuations that's also in your factors. And so it's just gonna allocate 100% to sales growth and 100% to EV to sales growth. So I don't recommend you change the model like that because it does create problems. But let's actually create this ratio, and it's pretty easy to do. We just go over and find EV to sales. There it is in column U. And we divide it by sales growth. Now we have a negative number, so we got to put a formula in here. We have to say We're going to say if that is less than zero, then give me nothing. Otherwise, give me that. All right, y'all see that? So you have to look at your ratio and see what makes sense. Since sales growth can be negative, if a negative ratio doesn't make any sense, then you have to kick those companies out. All right, so I'm going to put that down. And that first one's going to be nothing. I'm going to copy that down. So I've got some ratios here. You see one company just is crazy. They're trading expensively and they have almost no sales growth. So I'm going to take all of these companies. I'm going to take them over to another page and then I'm just going to paste them as values. So now I have my PEG ratio. So let me sort it. So I can get rid of all the zeros and the NAs divided by zeros. So get rid of all of those. So now you've got this new ratio. And so let me sort it by company name. And let's say we're doing Monster. All right, so I keep bringing up Monster. And there's Monster. So what could you do with this? Well, one thing you do is you just graph them all if you wanted to. Just insert and just do a bar chart. And so where is Monster? Remember how I find Monster? I just take that number and add like 500 and Monster will stand out and just give that a different color. And then take that out. That's, if any of y'all know a better way of doing it, that, you know, that's just the only way I can think about doing it. So here, Monster looks really, really cheap in this approach. And there's a few that are just really expensive. So Monster looks pretty cheap, or you might have a few competitors. Maybe the entire soft drink business is real cheap right now. Who knows what that's going to be. But you can certainly do that. The other thing you can do is just do some really simple statistics. So you can look at percentiles. We could look at the 80th percentile and the 20th percentile. And we can look at the median. So let's try that. So we'll do equal percentile. Percentile 20th percentile. And then we'll bring Monster in there. We know where Monster is, they're in yellow. So you could do that as well. Just do a bar graph there. And you can see Monster is expensive versus the industry, but not in an extreme. So if you wanted to, I'll definitely give you extra points if you find something new or interesting to put in your paper. So this is something you can do with the data you already have. I'm pretty sure I'm not going to give you the PEG ratios. We'll see with tech stocks. PEG ratios usually work pretty well with tech stocks, but I get too many NAs, so I probably won't. But if you want to create your own PEG ratio, you certainly can do that. If I were doing tech, I would probably do EV to EBITDA divided by sales growth. So for consumer, I would do EV to sales divided by sales growth. For tech, EV to EBITDA divided by sales growth. And if I'm doing price to book, like for manufacturing, I might do price to book divided by earnings growth. Remember, we want to still keep it consistent. So if you're using something before interest expense, make sure you're dividing by something before interest expense. If you're using something after interest expense, like price to book, then you have to use something that's after interest expense, like growth and earnings. All right. And I don't know if the person who asked that question is here on this call. So if it was Alan, that's how I do it. If it was Victor, then this, I think it was Victor. So this is how I do it. But here's where I give extra points. Now, something like this is going to take you 30 minutes. So you got to decide if it's worth your time. An extra 30 minutes to put a new chart in that you find interesting. And, you know, so you have to kind of say, but looking at this, Monster looks a little expensive. We knew they were expensive. They're the fourth most expensive one in the entire group. But they're not an outlier, that's for sure. So they're well within the bands. All right, so I'll be building this model for y'all this weekend, and you're stuck with whatever I build. But you can see the things you can do, taking out those outliers. I might do that for y'all, just because I've got to find a model that works. So we'll see. I might be kicking out some firms. I just won't be able to kick out your firms. All right, so there's the second thing. So you got three things you're doing. You got just the historical PE ratios or price to books or whatever. You've got this model, ranking model. And then the third thing is the valuation approach, all right? So I'm not hearing any questions. It's a really small class tonight, but all right. So let me show you this last approach. And since y'all are here, you might want to bring up your company and just follow. Can you bring up your file with the forecast in it? Are y'all able to do that? Do I need to wait for you? I've got the Walmart file. It's that original one that you use for paper four. And if you use that for your forecast, you have the forecast in there. So I'm just adding a page next to the forecast. All right. Y'all need more time or y'all got it? I brought in this formula. You don't have to bring in this formula, but you definitely want to have it in your spreadsheet. It's this formula that the PE ratio should be the payout ratio divided by the risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium times growth. All right, so let's get started on it. There's somebody else to bring in. So what you want to do is just bring all this data in. From paper six and paper, well, probably just paper seven, six. We'll see, maybe paper seven. It just, you'll see when we get to the growth number. So what do we need? We need the payout ratio. I'll show you where we can get that. The risk-free rate. That one definitely comes from paper six. Market risk premium. All right, so the risk-free rate, let's say your risk-free rate is 2%. Maybe you're using that normalized. Your market risk premium is 6%. So whatever you used in paper six, that works. And then you want your long-term growth. That can come from paper six or seven. In six, you have the long-term growth for the overall stock market. You might be using that same number in paper seven for your long-term growth. For Walmart, I'm probably just going to use 4% for long-term growth. So now the payout ratio. What I can tell you here is the norm for the S&P 500 is about 50%. That's the norm. The other thing I can do is I can use my forecast. How could I use my forecast? Well, you go out to that very, very last year in your forecast. That very, very out year. For me, it's 2023. Some of y'all might go a little further than that. And you just go down. There's their earnings per share on line 50. And their dividends per share. Is line, I think, 94. Yeah, dividends per share is 94. So we want to take dividends per share and divide it by line 50. So that's going to be our, wow, they're right at the norm, aren't they? So we're going to take, so from your forecast, you're taking line 94 divided by line 50, which is dividends divided by earnings per share. It's not such a question mark. All right, questions on that? I don't know if y'all have caught up with me on
DPS divided by EPS.
DPS, you're right. Yeah, dividends per share.
Just for the last year.
I'm sorry.
The video was on. Just for the last year.
Or for the last year of your forecast, right?
Okay.
If your company's still growing fast after 5 years, you're probably going to have to go out a few more years in your forecast. If you didn't do that for paper five, you might just have to do it for this paper, because you really want this to be terminal growth. This is the growth when they become a normal company. I think Walmart's almost there already.
Can you click on the payout ratio formula again?
So yes, DPS divided by EPS. In this formula, the payout does mean the payout ratio. It's not payout in dollars, but it's the payout percent, the payout ratio. I should have put the word ratio in there. All right, other questions on that? All right, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna come up and you have to talk about this. You need to put at least a paragraph in your paper eight talking about your target PE. You essentially just need to explain these assumptions. So your target PE is just gonna use this ratio. It's gonna be the payout divided by the risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium minus long-term growth. I left out one thing, let's put that in there. My long-term beta for Walmart, I'm going to use the 0.7 for them. So you'll get that out of paper six as well. Now, if you want to, you can run scenarios on this by changing your growth and your beta. Well, I'll do that. I'll show you how you can do that pretty easily. Let's just put the formula in there. So it's really simple. You just do the payout ratio divided by open parentheses, the risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium minus long-term growth. There's their long-term beta. Now you might say, wow, that sounds like a really, long-term PE ratio. You might sound that, what really sounds like a really high PE ratio for Walmart. But you remember Walmart is a low beta company, and low beta companies generally have high PE ratios, not because they're growing fast, but just because they're low risk. So if I actually look at Walmart, y'all not seeing what I'm looking at, I'm just quickly checking on the internet, but see what Walmart's current PE is. I think it's in the 20s somewhere. It's 2365. So we're not too far off where we are today. You might also might discuss this in terms of part one of paper eight. You remember in part one of paper eight, you're looking at the historical PE ratios versus the industry versus the S&P. That might be something you want to look at here and just get a sense of that. There's no rules on how to discuss this, but you're essentially trying to figure out when this firm goes to its terminal growth, when this firm becomes a non-growing firm, grows about in line with the industry, with the overall economy, what should his PE ratio be? All right. So there we have the numbers. And so now what are we going to do? Any questions up to there? Because we're about to shift into the actual valuation here. And again, this is what Damodaran, based on his studies, says the overwhelming majority of people are doing. If you go to investment banking or look at models that investment bankers use, you'll see this approach quite frequently. So this is a pretty common approach. If your firm doesn't pay dividends, then you need to go out in your forecast long enough until it starts paying dividends. At some point, you need to have it start paying dividends. All right, so let's put the dividends per share in and the earnings per share in. And we'll do that for 2020, or I forget, whatever the first year of your forecast is. First year of my forecast for Walmart is, it's actually 2020. I've got a typo there. So I'm going to do 2020. Y'all can see that's just, I don't know why I did that. That doesn't make sense. So you should have, it should be 1 year after whatever's in column U. So if that's not true, just type over it and it'll fix the others. I think it's because Walmart was one of the few companies that actually had some 2020 data already. So go over as many years as you have. Most of y'all are just going out 5 years. And then go get that line 94 that we used up above. Bring in those dividends per share. And bring in your earnings per share. Again, that's line 50. You can kind of tell it's highlighted there, line 50. So we got our dividends per share, we have earnings per share. Everybody with me so far? You know, just interrupt me, you know, yell out, don't use chat because I never can see that. All right. Y'all have this built in your spreadsheet, or are you gonna not able to keep up with me? Hopefully you're able to keep up with me. All right, so then we're gonna get a target terminal price. And all we have to do there is we just take our earnings per share times our target PE, and that gives us the price that we're gonna have. So just take your target PE times your EPS forecast, and there's your number right there. Questions on that? That's the whole reason you do a target. And that's the reason Dan Madarin says this is not a discounted cash flow model, because most of your valuation is going to come off of that target price in 5 years. You're not really doing discounted cash flow. You're really doing a relative value model. You're just putting a few years of dividends in there.
What is it trading at right now?
Oh, above that. I always get Walmart cheap. Looks like a good buy. So it's 148 right now. We haven't got it yet, so we'll see when we get the entire back in there. So it's going to come in lower. So I've been generally getting Walmart as an expensive stock. I'm not all that confident with this long-term 4% growth rate, because I just don't know if, you know, my gut tells me eventually they'll stop building stores and their growth rate's actually going to be 2%. I think the market seems to be using like a 4.5% kind of growth rate, and that just seems excessive to me. So, you know, so I'm probably going to have Walmart. I'm sorry, I might have said cheap. I mean expensive. I'm probably going to have Walmart expensive, because I think 4% is about as high as I want to go with Walmart. But you have this in your paper 5. You have it in your paper 6 and 7, especially in paper 7. So you already have this. So then we're going to get the cash flow. So what are our cash flows? Well, they're dividends for the first 4 years. And then last year, we'll get our dividend plus we'll sell the stock. So there's our cash flows right there. One other thing to add on the top that I probably should have put in there, but we can put it down here. Let's get our discount rate. Y'all remember that formula, right? Risk-free rate plus beta times the market risk premium. So we can just go grab that up here. Risk-free rate's 2% plus beta times the market risk premium. If you don't know that formula yet, boy, hopefully you're gonna see it so many times. So CAPM is the formula that, you know, just everybody knows. So 6.2% for my company here for Walmart. All right, questions on that? So you got your discount rate. So then we want to do discounted cash flows. And that's why Dan Madarin says people are saying, yeah, we use discounted cash flow models, because you actually are going to discount some cash flows here. Now I'm going to do it kind of sloppy, but then I'm going to actually fix it up to do it better. But so we'll start with the 244, and we'll take the 244 and divide it by one plus our discount rate raised to the first year, right? That's how you discount a cash flow. You just take it one plus the rate divided by one for 1 year. And you can copy that over. You just got to change. Lock in your discount rate. And so in the second year, make it 2. The third year, make it 3. The fourth year, make it 4. And the fifth year, make it 5. All right, so just cash flow divided by 1 plus the rate raised to the first. That 1 is incorrect. I'll show you what the correct number is here in a second. And so your valuation is just the sum of those cash flows. So $102 is trading for $148. But if I use the 4.5, which I really think the market's using right now, I get something. Well, it still looks cheap. I mean, I don't know what the market's assuming here. 4.75 or something. It just seems way too much. It's possible the market's using a much lower beta because Walmart's beta has been so low. And you see that it makes a huge impact. All right. So before I do the sensitivity analysis, I want to make sure everybody's with me. So your valuation is the sum of those discounted cash flows. I mean, it's amazing how simplistic this is, but what Damodaran says, this is actually what people do in practice on Wall Street. I never use a model like this when I was a security analyst. I actually only picked this up because Damodaran says it was so important. All right, so how can we get this more accurate? Well, the way we get this more accurate is that Walmart doesn't pay its dividends at the end of the year. They pay their dividends evenly throughout the year. So to make this more accurate, instead of raising it to the 1, we'll raise it to the 0.5. Instead of raising it to the second, we'll raise it to the 1.5. So we'll just reflect the fact that the dividends are coming on average about 6 months earlier than we have in here. And then on this last one, we've got to do it a little bit different. We do the dividend divided by 1 plus the rate. Raised to the 4.5 plus the target price divided by 1 plus the rate. This one we do get right at the end of year 5. I don't know, I have too many parentheses, but I think that's right. All right. So the only thing I changed is instead of using 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I'm using 0.5, 1.5, 2.5, 3.5. And then for the dividend, I'm using 4.5. And for the stock price, I'm using 5 because I'm going to sell the stock right at the end of 5. So that's what it's going to be worth. Okay, questions up to there. All right, so how could you run simulations with this? So you've got, I mean, you could collect all of these or you could actually build it out in a few columns if you wanted to. But what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna use my 0.7 beta because I like that. So I'm gonna do a base case, which is gonna be beta 0.7. growth of 4%. That's going to be my base case. I'm going to do a best case, beta 0.6, growth of 4.5, which I really don't believe. And then my worst case, I'll do a beta of 0.8 and growth of 3.5. So I'm going to do those scenarios. So I've already got my base case, 103.10. So this is one way to do it, is just plug them in as you calculate them. And now I'll do my best case, 0.6 and 4.5. And that gives me 239. And then I'll do my worst case, which is 3.5 and 0.8. And that gives me 70.63, all right? So you can actually run scenarios doing this with the range of what you think might be true. So I'm going to look for the file I did for Walmart before, because I want to bring that in here. All right, questions up to there.
Professor, for
does anyone have a price for their company, or are y'all still catching up with me? Is someone have a question? I heard someone talking.
Yeah, it's me. Oh, it's me. It's Luis. I was just gonna ask for the sensitivity analysis. I guess would it make sense if we're gonna increase our beta to lower growth, or does it not have to be correlated that way necessarily?
Well, your best case is the lowest beta and the highest growth always.
Okay.
And your worst case is always your highest beta and your lower growth. Always put those together. It's going to give you more extreme numbers. I mean, you could run 9 scenarios, right? 0.7 with 4, 4.5, and 3.5. 0.6 with 4, 4.5, 3.5. If you wanted to, I mean, essentially, it'd be really tough to do the data table here. But you know, the data table we did, I showed y'all with the H model. You can just actually create your own data table and not have Excel created for you. So if you wanted to, you could run a bunch more scenarios. You just have several betas, several growths, and just, so you probably could do a data table on this one. I'd have to look at it and see how it would actually work. I think it'd be a little bit tough, but all right, other questions on that? You can see Walmart's trading. Now, one thing really, really important. This is our value as of today. It's not our value in 5 years. We think their stock will trade. I go back to my base case. Whoops. We think the stock will be trading for $124.09 in 5 years. But today, what we think we're worth, if we want to pay for it today, is $103. If we pay $103 today and we get these dividends and we sell the stock for that, we'll end up with a 6.2% return. That's what this is telling us. So if we get exactly these assumptions, everything works out exactly, we'll end up with our 6.2% return. So this is the value as of today. So it's comparable to all those other values you've already done. This is part of the paper I think it's always the weakest for paper 8. And I think some students just completely missed this part. You have the advantage you're seeing it the first time. And so when you see it the second time, it won't be quite so shocking when you're doing it for your company. Some of y'all hope you've already got it built for your company. It still amazes me this is the most common approach, because I don't like this approach at all. I don't think it's a strong way to value the firm. It puts so much of the value of the firm in this one little thing, this target PE ratio. Just puts way too much there. So I don't like it from that standpoint. We were talking at the investment society meeting on Monday, why are growth stocks, why do they hate interest rates more than value stocks? But if you got a growth stock where they're not paying any dividends at all and you're going out many, many years, if you have to go out many, many, many years before you're actually getting a cash flow at all, the discount, that's going to make that stock valuation very sensitive to interest rates. When anytime interest rates rise, it's going to bring up your discount rate, and boy, the value that's going to fall. So yeah, growth stocks are much more sensitive to interest rates, and you've seen it pretty heavily the last few days. Boy, it's amazing how much NASDAQ has been moving with the 10-year treasury the last few days. It's not a perfect relationship. There's a lot of other stuff going on, but it's certainly, this shows it. All right, I'm not hearing any questions. So I'm going to take this and I'm going to take it over to the other spreadsheet I built, and hopefully y'all remember this other spreadsheet. I'll bring it up here in a second. If I can find it, there it is. Y'all remember this, doing the data table? It gives you some valuations. Up here, we had a best, worst, or we had three models. So what do you want to do? So at the end of paper 8 is really, really important. You want to bring everything in. One final valuation analysis. You want this really, really strong at the end of paper 8. If you do it at the end of paper 7, what I'm actually going to recommend, if you do it in a paper 7, I really want to actually grade it. You can put it in there just as a habit. But if you put it in a paper 7, I recommend that when you do paper 8, you take it out of paper 7 and put it at the end of paper 8. So paper 6, you'll come up with your discount rate. Paper 8, you'll do kind of cash flow valuations. Paper 6, discount rate. Paper 7, your valuations, but discounted valuations. Paper 8, relative valuation. Then at the end of paper 8, you'll do a final summary of everything that you've done before. So you might look at some of the papers. That's one of the things I wanted to do tonight is look at some of the student papers on paper 8 so you can see somewhat how they've done that. But think about what you have so far. So you got the capitalized earnings model. You got the dividend discount model. You have the H model. You have the historical relatives. You have the ranking model. And you have the target PE model. So that's all the things you have. How do you take all of this stuff and get it in the one spot? So there's a few ways to think about this. We haven't gotten this yet, but if you have a best, or a base, best, and worst, you could put all of those here and mark them red if they look expensive, and green if they look cheap. You could certainly do that. Another way I like thinking about this, well, let me put this in here. So let's say I didn't do capitalized earnings model, but let's say we got $68 $98, $128, and $62. Let's say that's what that is. All right. And then my dividend discount model. Let's say I'm going to use this ratio, this one right here. So I have my worst case, my base case, my best case. My H model, I'll do the same thing on the H model. I'm going to find my 4% growth. I'm going to go right there. So I got my worst case, my base case, my best case. Historical relatives, this one gets pretty simple. You might not have anything but the base. But let's say it was trading 20% rich. Then in that case, you just take the current price times 1 minus 20%. You just put that in there. I don't want to load that other file. But the current price was 148. I'll take that times 1 minus 0.2. Or you might say it was 5% cheap. 20% rich, so you might put that into your model. So 5% cheap, so there I multiply by 1 plus 0.05. Here my base might be 10%, and my worst case might be the 20%. You kind of see what I'm doing on that first part of this. You know, look back and see, was your stock trading generally rich or cheap? So you might get a range on that. The ranking model, I'm not really sure how you put that in there, but we do have this model here. So we can put that in there. Here might just say trading cheap and just put it in there as a just something you're talking about. All right. So the key is you can somehow get everything all together. And then what you do is you say, what's the median of all of these? Yeah, it's not going to let me do that. So let me get this ranking model out of there. Go Bill Gates is always there to mess things up. So equal median all the way across. And then we got the current price. The current price is 148, I think 0.09 or something like that. So what do you do with all of this data? All right, is any questions up to there before I show you how you can use this? And then we'll look at a couple of papers just so you can see that there's many different ways to do this. No questions? So find some way to go back to your paper 7 and all of your paper 8, just try to figure out. You might have to manually key these. You might have to make just some assumptions or whatever, but all right. So here's what we're gonna say. Upside, downside. So if you think about it, if this stock is worth 103.10 and it's currently trading for 148, you've got a 30% downside there. You'll see that. You take your valuation divided by the current price minus 1. So in the base case for 30%, we got 30% risk. The best case, we have 5% upside. And the worst case, we have a 39% downside. What does that tell you about Walmart? Probably not going to be a strong buy, probably going to be a sell recommendation. Have very little upside, a lot of downside. And based on that, I'm probably gonna make a recommendation not to buy the stock. All right, y'all let that sink in and think about it. You're probably all wondering, how do I get all these numbers? But you can see how I just went to the table and found a part in the table that I consider be my kind of my base case. You don't necessarily have to go across like that, because then all you're doing is looking at your betas, but you know, find some way to get that. So find a way to summarize it all and get it into one place.
Is this file part of what you're building for us? Or
no, this is not. This you have to build in yourself in the Excel file used for paper 4. So yeah, if you're not following all, you have to watch this video. I'm sorry?
Like earlier in the year?
The Excel file you're talking about or what?
I just meant like that table, this page or whatnot.
Yeah, I'm not fine. So ask that again.
I was saying, did you do this with us earlier in the year or?
Well, we did this in a video, right? You got this. Does this look familiar? So I did a video for paper 6 and 7. So that's where all of this came from. I mean, I don't have any problem putting this Walmart. I'll put this Walmart video Excel file out there for y'all, but you won't really be able to use it for your company. You have to build it. So I gave you the Excel file for paper 4, which is what I use for the forecast. And then I built this file for the video for Walmart, where I walk through paper 6 and 7. I know some of y'all have already been through it. What I'm doing here, I'm just now making up on the fly. Saying is find some way to bring in paper 6 and 7 together to get some kind of final recommendation on each one of these. And I like the base best worst case scenario. This is not unlike what the CFA Institute has recommended, showing several scenarios and trying to get what's the central tendency on your scenarios and try to see if the stock's trading rich or cheap. So I don't know, Max, if they answered your question, but I mean, you're if you haven't gotten through the videos for paper 6 and 7, yeah, this is going to be a little confusing because I'm referencing back to those. Everybody have a data table in their paper 7. Definitely. All right. So this is not a bad approach. This is the way I like to invest, is how does my upside down look versus the downside? I have more upside than downside, or if it's skewed one way or the other. This one's skewed to the downside. So it's like, why would I bother investing a stock that I might make an extra 5%, but I could lose a third or more of my money? So I don't like that, those odds. Some of you might have a company that's skewed the exact opposite way, where you're really, really skewed. Your worst case is only -5%, but your upside is like 50-60%. In that case, you would have to recommend a strong buy. Questions up to there? All right, so let's look at, what I wanna do is look at the Micron paper. I might look at, yeah, we could look at Microsoft, but that's a really scary paper. So I'm not gonna do that one. So let me load that up and then I'll share it with y'all. So Windows, where is it? There it is. All right. All right, so, all right, it's not, just a second, my machine is, there it is. Okay, can y'all see Micron here? Is that working? Are we good? No one's saying yes, so.
Yeah, we see it.
Yes.
I can see it, all right, because I'm worried my machine's like starting to break down here. Let's go to the very, very end, and let's just look through this paper. Here's paper 7. All right, and here's a relative value analysis. So you can see his company is pretty messed up, but he's using the files straight from that file I'm creating for y'all this weekend. And he's just using graphs from there. You can see his did not work very well at all because his company was just a mess. Some of y'all might have that problem. EV the sales worked a lot better. Price to book worked a lot better. Price to book might make sense for Micron. So EV the sales versus their industry, price to book versus the industry. So he cleaned up the charts. You can tell he made them a lot prettier and just made them look a lot nicer. So he cleaned them up just to look more professional than what I built. You don't have to do that. It doesn't bother me that I see there. He did a price to cash flow, and I told you I might build that one in. Put that in there. See, that works pretty well for him. You can see his stock, it just looks cheap everywhere. He didn't do a ranking model, he did a regression. I do not recommend doing a regression, so I'm gonna ignore that. And so you can see here at the end what he did on the relative value. So he has a summary chart just on the relative value. That's fine, you could do that if you wanna put that in there, but just to say where are they versus the market, where are they versus the industry, overvalued, undervalued, fair valued. That's not a bad chart to put in if you want to. Then he did the target PE. You can see how he did it. He actually did the three scenarios. He did scenarios on payout, which is fine. He did scenarios on beta. He did scenarios on growth. And that gave him his target PEs because his discount rate is so high and his growth rates are so low, his PE ratios were really low. And so that gave him he didn't quite do it the way I did in Excel, but his firm wasn't paying dividends. So he did it a little bit differently. So it's because his firm wasn't expected to pay dividends for 10 years. He just valued the stock price itself. And that gave him the target prices. Now what he didn't do that I want you to do, and he doesn't have it in here, is an overall summary of all of his models. So you need to take, whatever he did on each section and find some way to bring in a summary at the end. He did a good job of summarizing each section as he went. So that's actually where he probably did pretty well on the scoring. I probably took some off because he didn't have an overall ending section that summarized all of this. This is a lot of data for some of the to understand. You can look up here. He's got the different valuations. So here he did it. This is at the end of paper 7. Here he summarized all of his models from paper 7 and what their valuations were. He did the average and the median. So you can see he's doing something very, very similar. But So what he should have done is taken this last chart here and found some way. He could have just brought it to the end of paper eight if he wanted to, and just find some way to bring it all back together. Where is this firm trading? You notice part of his analysis is subjective. I mean, it's not subjective, but it's just it's qualitative instead of quantitative. So if you want to, just have one page that summarizes everything, but not necessarily one big chart that you can compare them all, that's fine as well. So what I'd recommend if you're doing something like this, bring it all back again. I like how he did this. I really like the fact that he put a summary at the end of each section. I would then repeat it again at the end of paper eight and just bring it all back together again, just so you can see everything you have. All right. Another one I want to show. I'm going to show you Microsoft just because it's a scary paper, but I think, can y'all see Microsoft here, hopefully?
Yeah, that is a scary paper. Was that a grad student or something?
No, undergraduate. I'm actually pushing him for a job. I've been getting a lot of leverage out of his. He's just cut out. This guy was just cut out for, I don't know if y'all know him. He's a grad student now, but he wasn't a grad student when he did this paper. He's just cut out for being a security analyst. And I'm kind of surprised he's not in that field yet, because first of all, you can tell he really loves doing this. And this is pretty incredible amount of work. But he loves doing this, but at the same time, he gets into the details. So there's this paper seven. He did the data table on paper seven. Even added other models. He had like a Damodaran model, which I can't remember what that was all about. And then he gets into the relative value analysis. He did it a little bit differently. You could actually do this. What this does is it just graphs their PE over time. You have that in the file if you want to do that. The problem with this is PE ratios change over time because markets are changing over time. So the S&P itself is changing like that. So I'm not a big fan of that, but that's the way he did it. But he also does the relatives as well. So here's the relative analysis that he's doing. Microsoft, the software industry, just showing where they are over time. That to me makes a lot more sense. You can see Microsoft trades cheap to its industry. I don't know what he did there, so I would ignore that. Free cash flow yield, man, he's adding a lot of extra stuff. I mean, he's really getting into this stuff. He did a free cash flow yield. I don't really recommend that. And he did some regressions. So yeah, he kind of got a little bit carried away. So at the end, boy, he's doing extra stuff where he's looking at actual analyst recommendations. You can't do that because you don't have access to Bloomberg. But you know, he brought that in. I guess it's good showing you his paper because just to show you, there's a lot more we could do besides what I'm giving you. Then he does the regression model kind of thing. He shows his factors. This is really nice. You might think about doing something like this because you'll have it all in the spreadsheet. Just a summary of the factors. He added a few extra on his own. He built his own model. I'm building your model, so you're stuck with whatever I did. But you can see the kind of things that he did. And then he needs to have a graph of all that at the end, and he does. Here's his graph. Again, he did a regression model versus a ranking model. I used to do regression models because that's the way Damodaran did it. And I stole it from him. But regression models are incredibly frustrating because you can almost never get good data. So I'm going to force you to do a ranking model. But here he shows Microsoft a little bit rich versus others, and he marked some other firms. He brought in a PEG ratio and did another model. So he really overkill on this. I was surprised he still had energy at the end. So what I really want to do is to show you the very, very final. So chart 130. You might look at his chart 130 just to see. He shows the final average valuation for each one of his companies. I mean, each one of his models. He even called one of them sweet because he used the capitalized earnings. The one thing he's missing here is he should have put in a different color the actual current stock price. And that would have made life stronger. So here's a way you can summarize everything. So he's got a lot of stuff, you know, even has the Damodaran model in there and a sweet model. That's kind of cool to see my name next to Damodaran's, even though my model's a lot simpler. All right. So this is overkill. I'm probably scaring y'all by showing this paper, but the main key I wanted to show you was the end of how he summarized the whole thing just to bring it all together. If you don't want to do it like this with numbers, then I would try to find a way with colors to take each one of your models, and maybe you have the H model, and maybe it's dark red because the firm was really rich. Maybe the dividend discount model was pink because it was a little rich. Maybe a cap earnings model is dark green because it's very cheap. And you use color coding all the way throughout, and you have one final summary chart. However you want to do it, just find some way to bring it all together. This is a really key part of your paper, because this is when you finally come in and say, is this firm overvalued or undervalued? Because he has so many models, it takes him a while to summarize everything. But, well, actually it doesn't. He did it all in one paragraph. All right, questions on that? I mean, I'm not giving you a specific thing to do. You're just going to try to find what makes more sense with how you've got your paper 6, 7, and 8 structured. This all does come from paper 7 and 8. I know it looks like this is 40 papers from him, but this is really just 2 papers for him, paper 7 and 8. And you just want to go back and bring all that together into one final summary. All right, questions on that? If you're struggling with this, then finish your paper 8 up until the summary, and then call me and we can look at your 7 and paper 8, and maybe I can give you some ideas of how you can bring it all together. It's going to be different for every company and every student. Just depends on how you did 7 and 8. But we can probably find some way to bring it, to summarize it all into one final recommendation. All right, any final questions on 8? We're going to leave 8 here, and then I'm going to be working all weekend. I know y'all don't care about that because you've been working all weekend, but I'll be working all weekend to build y'all's files, and I'll get them out there on Blackboard pretty soon. I'll probably put them out there as I build them. No final questions?